Hello, everybody. Welcome to What's Going On Here. I'm Bob Venn, and I'm standing with Helen Allen, the
director
at the Historical Society building at 48 Court Street in Plattsburgh, corner of Brinkerhoff. Corner of Oak. It's not very far from Brinkerhoff. And you saw the show last week, I hope, and we couldn't get it all on, so we're going through the rest of the tour today. Please stay with us. We'll be on here for an hour or so. And thanks for watching Hometown Cable. We're in the first room after we left the area where things are for sale and for admitting. What do you call this room, Helen?
This is the Orientation Gallery. It's the first gallery in the museum that a visitor sees and comes into. And it's devoted, as you can probably see, to the early military and naval history of Lake Champlain. We know that prior to settlement on this side of the Champlain Valley, really what was of tremendous importance were the naval events that took place on Lake Champlain. And in the case of the Battle of Plattsburgh in 1814, the military activity that was taking place on land. So we have some very interesting and very rare materials on view here. You're seeing an extremely rare print of the Battle of Plattsburgh, which was made by Nathaniel Currier, a name that's familiar to many people, and that was before he went into partnership
with Currier and Ives. Is that right?
He was on his own for a while in the mid-19th century, and that was when that print was produced, very rare one.
Do you know where that came from? Was it in the city, or was it sent here from somewhere else?
It came from elsewhere, and it was given to the museum by a benefactor just about a year ago.
Mm-hmm.
On the right of it is the rather important print of the Battle of Plattsburgh, shown as McDonough's victory on Lake Champlain.
Mm-hmm.
The battle took place on September 11, 1814, and that's a beautiful print, hand-colored, shows the action taking place in Cumberland Bay.
It says here, presented in memory of Dorothy Hines Ransom, President Clinton County Historical Association, 1977-78 by her family, and we're all indebted to
absolutely
for the family for
yes,
that.
It's wonderful.
Then, and first of all, I call this a room, and you called it a gallery. Everything in here is a separate gallery. Is that the right?
Well, we refer to the separate rooms in the museum
as
galleries.
Well, yes. All right. There'll be no more rooms mentioned on this show then. Okay.
Oh well, that wouldn't.
No, no. Now, this here shows the plan of the bay.
Yes, that's a rather rare piece, which was actually circulated it went along with the print of the battle that we just looked
right at.
And this shows the lineup of the two fleets, American
right
and British,
here, yeah,
in the bay.
This is Cumberland Head Point out here and goes around, and the city is right over in this area.
Right, that's right. That also was given to the museum by a benefactor some years ago, and it's extremely interesting to historians because it's a very accurate representation of what was happening in the battle.
Now, have you ever considered, say, making a copy of something like that to have available for sale for $1, 50 cents, $2, whatever?
Yes. As a matter of fact, there are a number of objects in the museum that people would like to do that.
I'm sure if you could, if you can do it, you know,
yes,
it would be great to do it.
It takes a bit of money to invest in these things, of course, as you can imagine.
Now, this is the reenactment here, or I should say a replica of that picture, and this is the bay of the Cumberland Head Point I was telling you about,
yes,
right there.
Yes.
There's the bay, and there's the city over here, and there's the fleet. And this island, you know what that was?
Crab Island.
That's Crab Island.
Yes,
all right.
Yes. This is a wonderful diorama that was given to the museum by the Plattsburgh and Clinton County Rotary Club. And it's beautifully done. A lot of people will remember Arto Monaco at Land of Make-Believe in Upper Jay. Arto Monaco and his staff created this diorama. And as you said, it shows the Battle of Plattsburgh, 1814, mm-hmm, in Cumberland Bay. The promontory, or little hill over there, is Bluff Bluff Point.
That's where the college is.
Where Hotel Champlain
was.
And is now Community College.
Mm-hmm.
Going back in time.
This over here, excuse me, but that was the
Village of Plattsburgh.
Oh, that's the city. Okay, I'm sorry. Here is where I would be now, Cliff Haven.
Yes.
Or the summer school was right in this area right here.
Yes. That's the Saranac River. That
it comes down through, right?
Ribbon of blue coming
crosses
through.
Crosses right underneath, right over underneath.
And of course, you can see in that corner there was a military encampment. That's where General Macomb was headquartered. Now, moving south, we're actually going back in time to 1776. And this is Valcour Island. The battle you see here took place between the American and the British fleets in 1776.
All right, now the battle was on October 11th, 1776. And if you saw our show with Mr. Doyle, when we looked at the Philadelphia 2, we were actually right over on this point here someplace with the camera. We were looking across at Valcour Island, I believe, yes, this way. And they were talking, and then the replica of the Philadelphia was over next to the shore. And this is very, very significant. And here you have this, what do we have here? 50 years, give or take,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
On one diorama, you call it?
Diorama.
And it's appropriate that there's a lot of water on something that Mr. Monaco made, because poor Mr. Monaco was flooded out, I think, 9 times with the land of make-believe, and it finally put him out of business with the floods he was getting in Jay.
I'm afraid so. It's worth remembering that the commander of the American fleet in the Battle of Valcour was Benedict Arnold, who was commanding that fleet on Lake Champlain during the summer and fall of 1776. Across the top of the diorama, in this large portrait, you see Commodore Thomas McDonough, who was the commander of the American fleet in the Battle of Plattsburgh in 1814. An extremely important battle strategically. It was the last time that the British tried to invade this area from Canada in order to get control of Lake Champlain. And the portrait on the left is of General Alexander Macomb, who was the commander of the American land forces.
And you mentioned was down in that corner where his encampment was.
Yes, that's correct.
And this was presented, the Battle of Plattsburgh, by the class of 1932 at Plattsburgh High School?
No, actually
no.
At the Normal School.
Oh, at the college.
And
okay.
Yes, and that is currently on loan to the museum.
Now, there was a picture in the book I talked about last week on the
Pictorial History.
There was a picture inside if you bought it. Pre-sale. Is there a picture in there now also?
Oh, I'm sure there is.
It's loose,
yes.
Inside? Okay, that's...
Oh, you're talking about Herd's history.
Yes, Herd's, yes. There was a separate...
We sell these separately.
Okay.
Now, but they're only about $1.
Okay.
So they're very affordable.
And you should have those. You should have it.
Yes.
You live in a very historical area, folks. Now, this is more or less, quote-unquote, a permanent gallery.
That's correct.
Because this is never going to change. There's nothing any more historical than this. I mean, as far as...
No, but we do rotate certain exhibits, such as in this case, the 18th century embroidered waistcoat belonged to William Gilliland, a very early pioneer in the Champlain Valley. Textiles such as this one are very fragile, and they don't stay on exhibition all the time. You know, they must be mm-hmm. cared for. And this will probably be shown in its case here for maybe 4 to 6 months, and mm-hmm. then it will be removed and put back in careful storage for a while.
And the exhibits do evolve here. There's always something, a center or a centerpiece or something, a central theme. Right now it's dolls, so that you can come here 2 or 3 times a year and get a complete different... This will be here, diorama will be here.
And this exhibit will stay pretty much the same because there are some extremely important materials in it, such as the print showing Samuel de Champlain's encounter with the Iroquois in 1609. Champlain drew this picture himself, and it was published in his journal in 1613. So this is a really important and very mm-hmm. valuable print. The sword on the middle shelf was presented to General Macomb by Congress after the Battle of Plattsburgh for his gallantry. And the rifle at the bottom, it was presented to, is one of several that were presented to a group of young men, actually boys, who jumped into action in the Battle of Plattsburgh. I think they really enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And afterwards, Congress awarded them each a rifle for their assistance in repulsing the British.
Mm.
So there are, in this case, there are some very important early objects historically.
It says here, this gun here was handed down in the Barton family, and I say the Barton family got it to the museum.
Yes.
I think that was in the paper when that was done. I think
indeed.
There was, yes, I remember that when that happened.
The family are descendants of the well-known medical family in Plattsburgh. The Dr. Bartons, yes.
These are buckles, by the way, right here. Shoe buckles. Waistcoat and shoe buckles.
Which belonged to William Gilliland.
Part of the early pioneer.
Yes.
1734, 1796.
Well, that's, there is also...
We had a battery replacement, so please bear with us. Yes, Helen, you were telling us about the cannon. It's not a cannon. Tell me what it is.
A swivel gun. Which would have been mounted on the side of the ship.
Yes.
Unlike a cannon, which is fairly inflexible in its positioning, the swivel gun could be moved around to face the
mm-hmm.
enemy ship. This one was found by scuba divers off Crab Island back in the late 60s, and it's a very fine example. It was made in Britain and was probably captured by a French ship and then thrown overboard, we think,
mm-hmm.
when the French ship was captured or scuttled just off Crab Island.
And remember, Crab Island was the small island just off Cumberland Head, right here, the small island. And you saw one of those if you watched our show on the Philadelphia 2, and they fired it for us, courtesy of that. And we'd like to thank Russell Doyle for being so courteous to us on such a short notice at that time. And because of things like that, I know what you're talking about, even though it's the first time you've told me this. All right, and then you have like an anchor?
Yes, that's correct. It's a small anchor,
okay.
Also found in the lake. Very important maps. This one, well, let's go to this one first. Chronologically, this was one of the early maps of the Champlain Valley, 1762, made for a British general, and it shows much of the lake with... places that were already, of course, there weren't too many settlements or anything like that, but it shows military events and developments
mm-hmm.
up and down the lake.
Let me just show you. This is the border right here, and you come down, and Plattsburgh, here's Cumberland Bay right here. And this is Cumberland Head at this point, and then this is your Valcour Island, I guess,
mm-hmm.
right
That's,
here.
Yes. Now, in the corner, we have a model of a Revolutionary-era galley. This gives you a good idea of what these ships on Lake Champlain looked like. And this is on loan from the Adirondack Museum at Blue Mountain Lake.
Another place you should visit. We're going to have to get there sometime.
The map in the corner here is of, it shows the Battle of Valcour, 1776, which took place, as you said, in October.
Right, that's right over here.
And when you think of it, pretty amazing. In 1776, the battle took place beginning of October. This was published in London in December of the
is
same year.
Is that right?
Yes. Copies of this map are quite rare.
I would say, and what a place to have it, right where it should be.
Yes.
That's unusual to have things where they should be.
Well,
we shouldn't let them get away if they're published in our area sometimes. We're going to move in, I guess, from this gallery. There's one into the next gallery here. What was this room? Have you any idea originally what this room was?
This area of the museum was latterly, when the law firm was here, used as offices.
Okay.
But we have... reconstructed this part of the building quite substantially. So it really looks quite different.
Okay, all right.
Just before we move in here,
mm-hmm.
there's a portrait of General Moores, Benjamin Moores, who was the commander of the militia during the War of 1812 in Clinton County. And below, people do love to see this. It's a ball and chain.
Oh, yes.
which was dug up on what is now the Plattsburgh Air Force Base and, of course, was a military barracks dating from the War mm-hmm. of 1812.
Mm-hmm.
Put that around your ankle and you wouldn't be able to move very
That's
quickly.
That's right. Did you just see the Plattsburgh paper where they arrested somebody down at Fort Ticonderoga for
yes.
being on the property with a metal detector? You know, and
very
it's very unfortunate, yes. Now, General Moores, we assume the way it's spelled, M-O-O-E-R-S, could very well have been Moores, New York, named after
this.
It was.
Benjamin Moores became an important person in Clinton County. He was sheriff at one point, county treasurer. So he fulfilled a number of civilian functions after he, after the war was over. An important person.
A man worked with me at customs, and his grandmother, by way of his wife, her name was Moores, M-O-O-E-R-S, lived in Burlington now, could very well have been a descendant of this man.
Very possibly.
Okay.
Yes.
We've moved south, in other words, toward Court Street from the back of the house toward the front, and we're in another gallery, Helen.
Yes. These two galleries, and the theme for these is the early settlement of Champlain Valley, are particularly interesting because architecturally, the two rooms that you are seeing here, one opens into the other, are part of the main structure, the original structure of the house. So I believe that what you're looking at right now are the two parlors, which were part of the house when it was built in 1805. And we always point out to visitors in these two rooms that there are wonderful architectural details, such as the crown moldings around the doorways and the windows. Very, very handsome. Beautifully.
Yes. And the floor, they call them upboard. Look at the, they're nearly a foot high all the way around.
Very nice. In between the two galleries are pocket doors, which were still in place. When this was the law firm occupied the building, that a wall had been erected to, between the two rooms to create offices, but we opened it up, and the space flows very nicely as a result. And
do those doors meet in the middle? Those are unusually wide pocket doors.
They do. Yes,
very
they
wide.
Do. They do.
All right, and. Now, the fireplace, of course, that's original.
Well, I think actually Rudy Blixt reproduced this fireplace,
okay.
which is very handsome. But as you can see, the details of the rooms are very nice.
Mm-hmm.
These two galleries hold objects that interpret the early settlement period of the valley. We're talking about 1784 through about 1850. As we go through these galleries. But in this case, there is the museum's collection of Staffordshire china. And you'll notice that the scene on these plates and other pieces is the same as you saw on the print in the previous gallery.
Oh, it's the battle?
Macdonough's victory on Lake Champlain.
Isn't that great?
This china was made in England for export. Fairly soon after the War of 1812.
I was wondering why England would make the battle they lost on China and to send...
Well, once the war is over,
yes,
you get
back to business and try to make a profit.
Absolutely. And this kind of china was made in the potteries in the Midlands in England.
Staffordshire, you call it?
Staffordshire.
Is that the name of the...
The
city, probably?
The area, the county
All
in
right.
which the china was made.
Right.
There were several firms making this china, mm-hmm. but this particular set and type was made by Enoch mm-hmm. Wood, a very, very well-known mm-hmm. name to china collectors.
Is there anything on the china that indicates it was the Battle of Plattsburgh? Yes, it does, right?
Yes.
Commodore's victory, okay.
The legend is exactly the same as it appears on the print.
So there must be sets like this somewhere else also.
Well, there's a set of Macdonough's victory in Key Bank in downtown Plattsburgh. The bank owns a set, and you'll find it at the Shelburne Museum in Vermont.
Okay, yes.
And in various other places.
But nowhere more appropriate than right here.
That's right.
All right.
That's right. One of the most important portraits in the museum is this one of Martha McClellan, who was an ancestor of the McClellan family of Champlain. And one of the reasons it's so important, as well as depicting Martha McClellan, is that it was painted by John Brewster Jr., who was one of the most important early artists in the United States. Late 18th century, actually this one was painted in 1810. And we are very happy to have that in the collection.
Don't forget that the McClellan family is direct descendants of Plenty Moore from Champlain.
That's correct.
Settler of Champlain.
Visitors will see various types of lighting, illumination and equipment on the mantelpiece here. A very early pair of bellows, which were used to get a fire going to produce air. And a beautiful
bed warmer, yes.
In the days when people didn't have central heating, you went to bed and the bed was freezing cold. Hot coals were put in this, the pan was put into the bed and then removed before you got into the bed.
You kind of rub it around and just warm up the sheets a little bit.
Yes, it did. And on the same theme, we have a foot warmer. If you were going out in your open carriage on a cold winter day, you'd put hot coals in here. And this is tin. The heat would come out through the perforated tin. Keep your feet warm.
Think about that when you're in your car, you just pushed a little lever.
Oh, yeah.
How easy it is now compared to how tough it was. And a few people who don't remember, and those of you who do, they used to have a glass that used to stick on your windshield with wire going through it that went into your cigarette lighter that would throw a little bit of heat to, that was your defroster for the window. I'm talking about in the 40s, late 30s, early 40s they were doing this. It's not that long ago, regardless of how old I look.
In this case, it's one of the oldest.
Yeah, I remember seeing that in your other museum. Yes,
yes. Yep. Yes. It's a 13-star flag. We know very little about it, but it's hand-sewn, made of silk. You can see how very fragile it is.
Mm-hmm.
Don't know who made it. It was found in the attic of a house in Plattsburgh.
Apparently it was a house flag made for patriotic occasions.
Yes.
I think.
And up above are the portraits of Mr. and Mrs. Abel Knapp, Maria Southwick Knapp on the left, they lived in Moores and operated a store there. These portraits were painted by Aziel Powers in 1841, who was an itinerant artist, one of the artists who traveled around. They would sometimes paint portraits just for bed and board or assess a small fee. And we have to remember that there was no photography in those days, so for an image of a person to be handed down through the centuries, the years, a painting, a portrait, was the means to do that. And they look very formal, but very handsome people.
Right. Now, I did talk to John and David after I left the museum last time. I mentioned I saw a Knapp that was related to the Southwicks. And don't forget that the Knapps and the Southwicks today are still the owners of the Champlain Telephone Company. So the Knapps and the Southwick are still partnerships, and she was related, I believe, to the Southwicks that are now in Champlain.
Just as an illustration of how objects come to the museum, these two portraits were given by one of the Knapp family who now lives in Colorado, who felt that the portraits should not be in Colorado, they should be back here in New York State in Clinton County.
You're here.
Yes, we're very happy that people feel that way.
And for you people who come here with the younger people, when you come to a museum, even though you have a tendency to want to put your hand and see how smooth it is, something else, you don't put hands on pictures like this or other things that are in here. It does wear after a time, right?
Well, I always say to school classes when they come in that the museum is one of the places where you can put your hands in your pockets and nobody's going to tell you to take them out.
Right. Okay. Now this in the middle, got a prominent place.
Yes, it does. It's this is extremely important in the museum collections. It's a needlework rug that was made by the Daughters of Pliny Moore in 1811 in Champlain.
Yes.
Plittimoor recorded in his diary in March 1811 that the needlework carpet had been finished. This piece, which is a fireside rug, was made to accompany a room-sized carpet made by the same young ladies and a stair carpet. And we believe that they learned their embroidery skills at a convent in Montreal.
One of the three, it's been identified by the Smithsonian Institution, one of the three oldest needlework floor coverings in the United States. If you remember, we've talked in the...
I just heard the doorbell, so I think we'll be right back.
All right. Helen's got out of mention, as you remember when we were talking before, in Champlain, I don't know if it was at the when we had our village picnic or village fest, I mentioned along the way there was a story about one of Plenty Moore's daughters going to a college over in a school over in Vermont, came back and married another prominent family into another prominent family in Champlain, and had a baby, and then she died, and her husband married the second daughter, and they could have very well have been the two who made it. Of course, he had seven children, I believe. I believe Pliny had seven children. And I believe one of them, I think that's the daughter. There were two daughters that I think married the same man. I think that's the family. Maybe I'm wrong on that. But basically, it sounds like that. Okay, that is very important. That's McClellan, probably from McClellan?
No.
No?
That came from a different family. There are still descendants in the area. Yes, but actually the Magat family.
Isn't that great?
In Chazy.
That's great.
There are very early documents in this case. But again, objects like this, very, very fragile documents that can fade, are not left on display for very long at a time.
Yes.
So we rotate these exhibits. Yes.
Again, I have mentioned on here, you'll notice... In the middle, try not to fold papers you put away. This is what happens to them, and they'll come apart in two pieces. There's another one. And because of a family like the McClellans and the Moores way back, we have so much paperwork.
Yes,
they kept everything, and it's important now.
Talking about that, we over in this corner, we have one of the original land grants for the area in Clinton County that was acquired by Zephaniah Platt, who is thought of as the founder of Plattsburgh. This one is dated 1787, signed by Governor George Clinton of New York State.
Remember, Clinton County, of course.
Yes, and it still has the original state seal made of papier-mâché, which is attached to it. Now, when the museum acquired this document, because it had been folded, it was in nine separate pieces.
Yes.
But we were able to raise the funds to have it repaired by a professional conservator, and you see it now as if it were the
in its original
condition.
Very important not to fold if you can help it.
So of course, that's difficult in
yes,
the case
it is.
Of
yes,
large,
it is.
Large
now,
documents.
Another thing that while I'm thinking of, because I know I've got it in my list, I think, that the Platt family, there's also a book that's available out in the shop about the Platt family, and written
by a descendant,
and then it talks about all the descendants that are listed.
And you'll find a lot of other familiar Clinton County names because many of these families intermarried.
Right.
Moores, for example, is one of them.
Okay.
There's a very interesting painting here, and I'll explain why this is so important. It's a watercolor dated 1796, painted of the house in Plattsburgh of Captain Nathaniel Platt, who was a brother of Zephaniah Platt. The reason that this is so unique and so important is that the house burned down in 1822. But the fact that it was painted gives us the documentation that shows us what the painting, what the house looked like, what its architectural style was. If this had not been painted, obviously, we wouldn't have any idea what
exactly
his first house looked like.
Exactly. Now, it mentioned that it was burned down in 18... It was placed by a stone mansion built by his son-in-law at 176 Cornelia Street. So I think the Platts were mostly, as you say, in that southwest quadrant of the city.
Yes, probably. The Charles Platt House is still on Boynton Avenue,
okay,
the White House that you can see there. Yes, that's true. You have to remember that Plattsburgh was much smaller, and the original settlement was in a very small area.
And you remember, that's not quite 200 years. And remember when we were up in looking at the Gulf and up there, we were talking 8 million years ago when they had the Ice Age and so forth. You know, 200 years is nothing compared to, but it is a long time. But when you think of all...
These are prints relating to the military and naval activity on the lake. Mm-hmm. And then we find ourselves in the next gallery.
Great, large portraits.
Yes. These are of Levi Platt, his wife Eliza, and of course they were very prominent people in the community.
Now, are they the family that had the Margaret and Elizabeth, of which these streets are named after?
Yes.
They were all named back up on the Platt. Margaret, Elizabeth, and a few of the other streets. Oak.
Well, a lot of these families were linked. And then, of course, in the another treasure in the museum, the 1784 map that was commissioned by Zephaniah Platt. And one of the charming things about these old maps of that vintage is that they have these quaint drawings that adorn them. They're not maps the way we have them.
And apparently for no reason, right? I mean, that doesn't have anything to do with the map, that house over on the left.
Well, that one may represent an actual building that was here at the time, but unfortunately we're not able to identify it. But you see the Dutch style of architecture in the gambrel roof, which was something that the Platts imported with them from the Hudson Valley.
Okay, yes. This I hadn't seen before, a flax wheel,
early 19th century. Reminds us of a time when women tended to stay at home and work very hard in the home to spin and weave.
They were professionals, differently than they are today. They were professional mothers and housekeepers and made the clothes and everything else, right?
And they were kept busy from morning
yes, they
till
were.
Night.
Yes.
They didn't go out to buy things the way we do, but they made them at home.
Right.
Such as this needlework rug, which was made in 18... I'm sorry. It's a crazy quilt.
I was going to say, if it's a rug, crazy quilt. All right. I was going to ask you about a rug.
I'm crazy too.
All right.
This is our lovely crazy quilt, which was made in 1855, beautifully preserved, and as you can see, has all kinds of different fabrics and stitches in it.
You know, museums have things you'll never forget, and here's obviously one that I'm never going to forget after seeing this. And of course, when we talk about Chaisy and a museum there, don't ever forget that large 30-foot braided rug in the kitchen. It's just a huge thing. You can never forget it. It's the centerpiece.
That's
and this
right.
has a very prominent, as well as the one in the other room,
the needlework.
Yes. And this is also, is this needle or is that silk?
Embroidered with silk thread, and this was made by Eliza Platt, her portrait over here, when she was 12, I believe. And this, it's a beautiful example of how young girls were already so proficient at needlework.
Didn't have television,
didn't have television or radio,
right.
stayed
yeah.
home, learned how
right.
to do needlework,
yeah.
which unfortunately is a skill that so many of us are not able to... preserve.
Right. Now, Fraley, I've never heard that name before, I'm sad to say.
Again, a family that intermarried with the Platt family.
Elizabeth was his daughter then? Is that correct?
No, this is Eliza.
I'm sorry, Eliza. Okay,
Miller.
Yes, I see here it says Elizabeth Dumas Kent Platt in 1830.
But very early settlers in this area.
Well, this dress was not common for most people. Most people didn't have those kind of clothes.
No.
Huh?
He was obviously a
yes.
prominent person, yes. And
very
well dressed, very elegantly dressed.
It didn't help him to live very long. He lived for 46 years, unfortunately.
But you know, at that time, even 46 was considered to be well on.
Yeah, maybe you were tired out after 46 doing everything, nothing be done for you.
And people's health didn't have the AIDS that we
right.
have nowadays.
Yes. We're right in the front southwest corner now. The street is right behind Helen in the window. That is Court Street right there. Looking right on the Court Street at the light. And this man here, it looks like he's, maybe it's my angle, I thought he looked like he had a frown on his face, but...
Also, an extremely early settler in Clinton County, Peter Keyes.
Keysville?
Yes, named after that family. His house still stands. It's the stone house at the corner of the Union Road and the Harkness Road. Sits back from the road, very strongly built stone mansion.
Mm-hmm.
And below is a very early musical instrument in Clinton County, a melodeon bought at the county fair by Andrew Hull, who was one of the early wardens at Clinton Prison.
And it's not a type of piano?
No, it's more like it would resemble a little bit more an organ.
Okay.
Phone? Ignore that. I believe
okay.
You can keep going. Now.
All right. And a scene by Richard Keyes. I guess maybe Richard Keyes?
Richard Keyes painted this portrait of his father. He was an artist, and he painted these pastoral scenes. Yes.
Uh-huh. And then he bought this, how do you pronounce it, melodeon?
Melodeon
for his daughters.
That was Andrew Hull.
That bought this one, bought this melodeon in Saranac. Okay, and we have another portrait. And again, the rabbit ear or something chair, a nice old chair, painted chair.
Yes.
Robert Platt.
Another member of the family.
And he lived to be 80 years old. So he...
That was very...
He had two lifetimes nearly. Yes. Now, the effect that you see of the on the canvas of the... I guess that's what that Joan was talking about as far as the dolls were concerned last week, like the little cracks, that's from the paint, huh?
Well, that usually results and it was very obvious in two of the other paintings. We think that the canvas had not been properly prepared when the artist started to paint the book. But of course, environmental factors have a lot to do with that as well.
Do you have to keep certain temperature in here?
We try to keep it low, not too low.
No,
obviously.
but
a very even temperature, and we keep the galleries cool.
Okay.
Yes.
And what days are you open, by the way?
We're open every day except Wednesday and Thursday from 1 to 4 in the afternoon.
You mean Sunday you're open and Saturday?
Saturdays and Sundays,
yes. Sorry, 1 to 4?
1 to 4 every day except Wednesday and Thursday.
All right. Wednesday and Thursday, anybody here where you can at least come in and buy books?
The museum shop is open.
The museum shop is open, all right.
But those are the days when we try to get a lot of our curatorial work done.
Mm-hmm. And in the morning, right?
And in the morning.
Well, you say we, all right? I've only seen you so far. You have some volunteers?
We do. And we also have another staff person who is not here at the present time. So it just so happens this afternoon I'm on my own, but that's rather unusual.
Well, aren't we fortunate for that? We have your time. Okay, now, as we go into this hallway, this wall, as I understand it, would have been the extremity of the original house. This was, and if you remember, we showed you, they added two more windows and about 18 feet. Maybe it went a few more feet back there. This may have been a closet or something, but where's the stairway? I'm sorry. It was a few more feet, and the stairway is a few more. Maybe it was another 6 feet where the stairway is, and then it ended. Then they added 18 feet. Rudy Blix did that. We'll be right back. We're going to be turning down and see some more of the doll collection, and then go into another section of the museum. We're at the Historical Museum for the Clinton County Historical Society. Courtesy today, our director, Helen Allen. I'm Bob Venn. What's going on here? As we pass by the collection of the dolls, which you saw last week if you watched our show, Helen, you mentioned this is not going to be here permanently, but how long will this collection be here?
Through the end of February.
This February? So
yes,
it'll be another
month
and a half?
Yes, that's right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then what will happen to it? Will you return to the library?
Oh, no. This collection of dolls has been placed here permanently in the museum.
It will stay right in this location?
No, it will be in the museum, but not necessarily on view.
I beg your pardon.
Record.
Okay, so then you'll have another display here. Is this where you're going to have, as you bring different things in for, like the firemen you brought in for a while, or different things you dedicated to, ice,
mm-hmm.
This will be the room that is done?
Not necessarily. We want to keep our visitors guessing. I'm
not guessing very well at all. You are keeping me guessing. All right.
These cases lend themselves very well to temporary exhibits of this nature, small objects that can be accommodated.
That's
in
the word I've been looking for, temporary.
Temporary.
Exhibits,
yes.
All right. So what we've seen so far has all been permanent, but not quite permanent?
That's correct.
All right.
Because certain objects should not stay on display all the time.
But the theme is permanent. All right.
That's correct.
Okay.
But then I'll be taking you into another gallery when it's not permanent at all.
Okay, so you're telling me yes, but no. All right. Now this is...
However, this is a permanent exhibit.
All right.
This is the museum's very rare and valuable collection of Redford glass. Made at Redford at the Crown Glass Works between 1831 and 1851. And these are what were known as end-of-the-day pieces. The factory made window glass, that was its reason for being in existence. But at the end of each day, when they'd made their quota of window glass, the glass blowers, and of course this is all hand-blown, made these objects for sale in the company shop, store, or for other purposes. And these were not exactly throwaway pieces, but they were, by the way, they were incidental to the business of the factory. Now, of course, these are the collector's dreams.
Mm-hmm.
And this is our prized collection.
Based on what you're telling me that the material that has been prepared for glass that day, that comes, give me a time when it's time to go, and you can't leave that overnight. So you got to do something with it, or it's going to be solid the next day.
That's correct.
So they tried to make something a little bit different.
Yes.
On their
exactly.
own. Okay.
Exactly.
So that they didn't make this commercially, so to speak.
That's what we understand.
I didn't realize that. Mm-hmm. Okay. There's a story here. There's also a story out front. We mentioned a book, $2.50 on Redford glass. Again, part of our long history up here in the Clinton County Northern Tier.
Well, that's an interesting story because it details the events in the short life of a factory working against all odds in what was really just wilderness mm-hmm. in the mid-19th century with difficult transportation problems, which was one of the things that eventually
right.
drove them out of business.
Redford glass known, well known throughout the country and maybe internationally.
That's correct.
Okay.
People come to see this from far away.
It was all that color?
Yes.
That one color.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That means they didn't add a color, so this is the natural color.
That's a natural color.
All right.
And
what's this chunk?
That's known as slag, and that's just a piece of leftover glass that had solidified. And until relatively recently, I'm told you could walk along the river at Redford and you might find pieces like that. I don't think you do anymore, however.
This here, this rare collection of Redford glass contains 34 pieces given to the Clinton County Historic Museum by Mr. and Mrs. Harold Boyer in memory of Eva D. Boyer of Moores, who I believe was a teacher.
She was a very well-known
antiques
dealer. Yes.
All right. From Moores.
Right, and she put together most of this collection.
All right, well then, there's some more information on an act to incorporate the Redford Glass Company passed April 23rd, 1832. Very appropriate to go with the collection.
That's right.
And we're getting into our, what do we call them today? We can't call them Indians anymore. We've got to call them Native.
Well, historically it's still called a cigar store Indian. This one was carved probably in New York City. It stood outside the Levy Cigar Store on Margaret Street in Plattsburgh for many years at the end of the 19th century, and is still in remarkable condition considering the wind and weather and the snow that it was subjected to. The bell in the corner is also Redford glass, and that's a cloche or bell jar used for covering seedlings
okay.
in cold weather.
All right. The Redford Company house, oil on a board. The artist is unknown. Lack of perspective adds to the quaint visual quality of this picture. It says finished 1826. Now, I don't know if that isn't necessarily the factory, is it?
No, that, no, no, the no house. That would have been the offices. Right. Okay. And that building is still in existence,
it
I
is?
Believe, and oh. had a porch added with bullseye panes of Redford glass in it.
All right, then this would be the vestibule from the house as it was known then, and as we, this would have been the end. This was the outside wall right here.
Yes, I believe so.
Before Rudy Blix added the section where we're going to go, well, I guess we're going in next, right?
Yes.
And a large room, which he probably used for the business, and he kept his house. This was probably for the business over here. All right.
This gallery is one in which we will have most of our temporary exhibitions. And what you're seeing right now is an exhibition honoring the bicentennial of the village of Peru, which was 200 years old in December. We've done this with a number of the towns and villages in Clinton County in the past, for example, Keysville, Champlain and Rouse's Point. And when, especially when there's been some important event such as a bicentennial, we have presented an exhibition which shows some of the history and some of the historical objects that have to do with that community. So this one is Peru. And it contains some objects from the museum collections, but also quite a number of objects that are on loan from Peru residents or people with a Peru background.
Let me ask you a question that may be difficult for you to answer, and maybe you don't want to answer it, and you don't have any other one to ask you. Are there enough people that come to look at these exhibits?
Oh, absolutely.
Is enough?
Well, there'll never be enough.
I mean,
no
but I mean,
I reconsider.
Like, here, let me say this. This is a Peru exhibit. I would think that you'd like to have close to half of the people in Peru come to see this.
Mm-hmm.
Would
yes.
you get anything like that?
What's the population?
I don't know. Peru, maybe the town of Peru, the whole town. I don't know. Maybe, let's say 4,000 to 5,000 people, maybe. I don't know.
Probably not.
Okay.
Probably
but it would
not.
Be nice. People should come in and look at their heritage. It's
yes.
right here.
Well, this is an opportunity to see a lot of material
one
pertaining
place.
To Peru in one
place.
One place,
exactly.
Which might not happen again.
Right. We all know the Masons. We see the Masons. We know of the Masons. We know of Clarks. They're very prominent there. And
what a lot of people forget is that at one time Peru had a very active Quaker union. And the lady in the corner is wearing an authentic Quaker dress. This is how a Quaker lady would have been dressed at the end of the 18th
okay,
century.
You say that Peru had that. Would they have it to the exclusion of the other parts of the county?
Well, the Quaker Union was located
right there
in
Peru.
Peru, just south of Peru, yes.
Now, this is probably the mill that was for the Masons where
That's
they had
right.
their plant right here, I would assume.
A very large painting.
Yeah.
Loaned by a descendant of the Mason family.
Now that's all closed up there now. There's no more. They made the woodwork there for many, many years.
Well, the mill is now an apartment building.
Okay, and now the closest to that is, I think it's John, who has the kitchen design out on Margaret Street. When I built my house, we got lumber. My grandfather got the lumber from Phil, John, and Mr. Mason,
I think
you know?
Many of us.
Oh, yes. Yeah. I don't know what A. Mason, what was A? Do you know what A was?
Albert.
Well, Bob,
Albert.
I didn't know that.
Yes.
Okay. And Cochrane, obviously, was an inn in Peru.
This is another of our very early pieces in the museum. It's a tavern sign. A man called Silas Cochrane operated an inn at Peru. This is in the late 1790s. Excuse me. And we know that, this gives us a piece of information, we know that that was where the Masons held their meetings, because
yes.
you can
symbol.
See the Masonic yes. symbol there. This is called, nowadays, this is called a piece of folk art, because you can see that whoever did the lettering on the sign did very nice lettering, but was not very sure about how to plot. So we think
he didn't plan ahead.
He didn't plan ahead. He got to his N and he said,
you see, the Cochrane and then the S apostrophe is on the top, so he didn't quite go.
He ran out of space, so he decided simply to go up into the line ahead.
You know, there's a joke like that where it says plan ahead and then the D on the end is up and around,
that's
you know. Up
right.
like,
that's
And this has got to have a story.
This is shown vertically, but in fact, it's a water pipe. Which would have been lying on the ground.
Yes,
probably.
Yes. Matter of fact, the article I read about Mr. Blix digging in the basement here, in the article, it's in the note, it said he found
a water pipe.
That's probably where it came from. No,
probably.
That's true. Down here, he also found seashells.
Oh, yes.
Which would indicate that there was the ocean or the seawater was here at one time to have the shells.
Well, Lake Champlain was at one time called the Champlain Sea.
Yeah.
And it was an inland sea.
Yeah, because the water here was probably 100 feet here because of the ice age and other things.
If you go to Valcour Island and you climb up, for example, to the Valcour Lighthouse, and you're pretty high up from sea, from lake level at that point, in the rocks, you can see shells and fossils. How did they get there? It was way up on top of the bluff.
Well, the way was just like we thought. This is very unusual. You don't see many of these.
This was a Quaker lady's bonnet trunk. I will open it for you to show you that.
Wallpapered inside.
Well, actually, this is fabric.
It's fabric
but
inside.
But sometimes they would have been. They would have used
fabric inside.
Yes, very pretty.
That and came from Peru, I take it, then, maybe?
Yes, from the Arnold, the Hoig family, yes.
Mm-hmm. Very unusual, large rocker right here.
From the Keys homestead. And there's a portrait of the young man who painted the portrait of his father.
Oh, Richard, okay, Richard. The one we saw, and it also had the small painting also.
That's right. There's a poignant painting in the corner here. It's on velvet. It's a mourning picture, and it's in memory of two young women who died in their 20s in the early 19th century. And you know, this was so common. People suffered from tuberculosis, and sometimes they were carried off at a very young age. This is a very typical mourning picture with the weeping willow and showing the gravestones, or well, you've seen those mourning pictures,
yep.
And very often there are members of the family who are grieving over these early deaths.
I was looking here to see what this was, 1825, 1826 in March. You're talking here within a year, two daughters had died.
That's right.
And well, that was not unusual because
in many families there were a number of children who didn't survive beyond.
I've been getting some information for up in Champlain for our church, and sometimes three and four children dying in a period of 3 years, diphtheria and these various maladies.
Cough, measles, all of that sort of thing. Yes,
had a lot of it.
The flag was found in the community church in Peru. We don't know anything about it except that it's a flag obviously commemorating men who went from that community to fight in one of the wars.
Mm-hmm.
The gold star probably represents a death, someone who was killed. But beyond that, unfortunately, we don't
right.
have
now, I'm looking here at Peru Bottling Company, and I'm not so sure that Peru Bottling Company means Peru, New York. I mean Peru that way because it's South Peru Street, I think it was called, or Peru Street. And there was a bottling company right where the just after you turn off Broad Street, down about 500 feet on your left, there was a bottling company, and I think Coke or somebody
That's
was in
right.
there, right?
But they took their name.
Is it from Peru, yes,
company,
right.
Yes.
And
the portraits are of Silas and Mary Arnold, also by Aziel Powers. They were very early settlers in the Peru area. You've heard of the Arnold Mine. Mr. Arnold acquired land there, discovered iron ore on it, and made quite a lot of money.
In Peru?
Near Peru.
Near Peru?
Yes.
Okay.
There are several mines very well known in that area.
There's still some Arnold families up in that area. I've seen the name, but I don't know anyone of it. A Quaker woman's costume.
That was the one that we looked at.
Oh, that's the one there. Okay.
Yes.
So that Arnold family. Now, this would also, some of this would be in that, the book by, the one that I have four of. what's your county book called?
The Herds. History,
Herds.
History of
I'm Clinton. Sure there'll be pictures like this, of
That's
this
right.
in Herds.
That's right.
And
now, there is a beautiful, but we ask visitors not to touch it. a beautiful friendship quilt, which is on loan to the museum from the Stafford, Mr. and Mrs. Richard Stafford. And it's a friendship, called a friendship quilt because people who signed their names on it. You see all the signatures
yes,
in the middle
yes.
of the blocks?
Yep, Arsable.
Very pretty and still in very nice condition, mostly.
Rouse's Point, Herrick's, like they've covered up. I hear you can see that it's worn. That one there is worn.
Oh, yes.
Worn here.
Oh, it has
it was
been used.
Used.
You see,
used.
This one had been used, whereas the crazy quilt that we looked at probably had not.
But how well the name stayed on. Arsable, a lot of people are Arsable, and here's another Rouse's Pointer. Names
well,
throughout here. Did you think they put that on there afterward, or were they did they put it on as they were made and they added it?
No, we believe that the quilt was taken perhaps to what was called a camp meeting.
All right.
A Methodist camp meeting, and at that point, people who were at the meeting signed their names.
Okay. We'll take a... Well, we got a little bit more here, and we'll continue on before we take a break and let Calvin worry about his shoulder later. Calvin, cast that on the camera. You're watching What's Going On Here. And what is going on is the new museum. I say new because it's in a new location. 48 Court Street. We're talking with Helen Allen, the director.
On the top, wonderful sampler made in 1802. That's pretty early for Clinton County. Made by a young girl. And again, as they learned how to do embroidery. And learned
Phoebe,
various
that's
stitches.
Right. Phoebe Underhill?
Phoebe Underhill, yes.
Halleck. I don't have her last name there, but yeah, Nine Partners Boarding School.
Well, she married into the Halleck family.
Uh-huh.
And below is a portrait, not a portrait, I'm sorry, a painting of the Barker homestead near Peru, just to the south of the village of Peru. And it's still there. But that was painted by Daniel Bigelow, who is one of our Clinton County painters. We have a number of paintings by him of various
mm-hmm.
scenes.
We've just left the Peru Gallery, which was right here to my left, and then to the right, where you saw, that was coming out of the hallway where the Dahl collection and the Redford Glass was, and now we're into what was probably one of the biggest galleries you have at one location. And first of all, how long will the Peru exhibit be here?
Through the end of March.
All right, all right. So that's your big one today is the Peru, not the Dahl. The Dahl is also, but the Peru is your central at this point?
That's correct.
All right. Now, as we start around here, a map again. I'm always enthused by maps. The village of Plattsburgh, village, 1850, circa, shows the streets. Here's Cornelia Street and Margaret, and you'll notice that what is Oak Street goes nowhere. Once it gets to Cornelia, just a few houses. And I assume that this property in here was owned by, up further here. Catherine Street, I'm sorry, I got to get up further here. William, you can't even see, not even on here. The Violet's home, that was the Violet's all that land up there.
Mm.
Okay, 1850.
These maps are extremely interesting because you can see that in this one, in 1850, west of Catherine Street,
yes,
the upper half of Couch Street was called Matilda Street.
Oh, yes. And Woodward Avenue, no longer?
Was the upper half of Brinkerhoff that was called Woodward. So, you know, the changes.
Yes.
And, of course, we're about to have changes again.
Yes. Oh, yes, we know that now. Over here, there's nothing on south of the river. There's no Hartwell, St. John's... of the others are not there.
That's right.
Which, by the way, it said on the paper yesterday or today that they're going to be mailing out the numbers. I don't know if that was Plattsburgh. One of the communities is going to be mailing out, I guess Rouse's Point is going to be mailing out the numbers. You're going to be surprised. There's not going to only be a few numbers change, as I understand it. Everyone's number is going to change, practically. All right, another quilt.
Another beautiful pieced quilt from the Keys homestead in near Peru. This is actually a Peru piece, but this is from the permanent collection. This case holds materials having to do with the medical profession, and you were noted.
I recognize a few things. You want to come over this side? Maybe why don't you get on this side for me, and I'll stay here till I can see you.
No.
Oh, Okay, as I look at the cases, various assortments here, we won't go through all of them. You can come and see these yourself. But a couple of things I noticed from a distance, of course, is the W.H. Minor right here. It's in this book, so it could be a yearbook. I'm not sure what that is, but it's pictures on the inside. And in behind is one of his calendars, identified or not. And one of the Heart's Delight medallions is hanging from it, because I have one just like that in my home, exactly like this. It's a leather-covered, I guess, yep. And the case, and in each, there's 12 separate pages that pull out and slip in. And I still use it today. I just make it the dates fit the right day of the week. Mm-hmm. And here's some pictures.
Well, the reason for Mr. Minor being included in this exhibit is that, if you recall, he gave the original hospital to the community.
And there's a little story about Mr. Minor. But I'm wondering, I wonder if that's the book about the hospital. That could be the hospital book.
Yes, it is. All right. It is, yes.
Mm-hmm. He put out one of those, and the Institute up in Shazy loaned Calvin a tape, and it was on Hometown Cable, 26 minutes of the physician's hospital taken throughout the hospital in 1926. Beautiful pictures.
Yes,
beautiful.
I'm sure they were.
Great. All right, now, Ostrander, a longtime name in Plattsburgh.
A barber shop on Upper Bridge Street in Plattsburgh, and then subsequently Ernest Jr. was a hairdresser on Brinkerhoff Street. So this is the kind of barber chair that you would have had your shaving done in, your hair cut.
Every morning, you had your own little cup, your mustache
that's
cup and the rest.
Yes. Over there is a pretty interesting piece of folk art. It's a carved piece, Christian, of course, symbolically. Don't know very much about it, probably French-Canadian.
But probably made out of one piece of wood.
Yes, indeed.
So that was carved within itself there, you know, and that's that was a great art in itself, just to be able to do that.
We have an exhibit here that it takes... a whole hour probably to look at everything. These are trade materials from various stores in Plattsburgh and throughout the county.
You want to come over here? Maybe he can look in there. All right. Well, yes, that right over in the right-hand top corner, you see Cronkite, Rouse's Point, New York, on that jug.
And several cigar boxes reminding us that cigar making was a big industry in Plattsburgh and at the turn of the century. The Merkels were cigar makers, and Levy's, and Shire's. That's a whole chapter of history in itself.
Coulomb on River Street in Plattsburgh. I never heard that name down there. And, of course, and above, the Sharon's Dry Goods, Carpets, Wallpaper, and Company. That was probably the Sharon's department store they had in town for the same family.
On Margaret Street, yes.
Yes. Gone now for a number of years. But these old boxes, I have some of these boxes, some of the boxes with the names of Plattsburgh on, and some of these boxes that were for candy had paper inside that looked like a doily, you know, with the folded over for the candy.
That's right.
Pal Blade, of course, for many years on River Street, they made the razor blades up until the early 50s, I think.
Yes, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And many people in this town worked at Pal Blade. Very interesting to look at this. This is a story in itself. Here's a standard shoes here. I think that said Plattsburgh, a shoehorn that they used, all with Plattsburgh names on it. You know, you at the time, you threw it out figuring, well, everybody knows. But
not just Plattsburgh. I see Shazy.
Yes, the area.
Point, the whole county. Because, of course, don't
Signer's
forget.
Dairy was in Keysville.
We are a county museum.
Yes. Dewey Stamp. Turner's Rexall Drug, that was Keysville, I believe. Great, great display.
Now here is one of my favorite pieces. It's a handmade square, and you can see that the man who made it inscribed his name and the date.
Yes, it's right here, Bishop. Huh?
His name was Bishop. We know nothing about him.
1793.
1793, yes.
Very interesting. And it's got its own light, and right on the name, so you'll see that.
And you'll like this.
Oh,
this
yes.
is a whole exhibit devoted to Pliny Moore and his and the Champlain, the history of the Moore family in Champlain. This is Pliny right here, a watercolor showing his original house. And we know that the one that's in Champlain now, which is a funeral parlor,
yes,
I believe.
Yes, you recognize it like this.
This one burned down and was replaced exactly according
yes.
to specifications.
1912, a fire that started over on Main Street, and it was replaced exactly the same because the McClellans who lived there was an architect in his own right and had some kind of reference to some plans.
Yes, he did.
And it was completely built the same way.
Pliny Moore's ladle, punch ladle, is in this case. And a lot of people will recognize this Adirondack twig chair, rocking chair, which used to be in Woody's print shop in Champlain. I remember it sitting there, and subsequently it was given to the museum.
Now, see, I've been in there, but I do not remember that. No, I don't remember that. I remember seeing it.
One of the reasons for this photograph of the original house is that on the porch you can see...
Oh, yes, the chair.
That chair.
On the right-hand side, next to the pillar, is this chair. Of course, now the home of Oral and Marilyn Parson, who live there, and they operate the Clark Funeral Home. Reggie Clark from Lake Placid, the owner of the Clark Funeral Home. Very interesting. Very interesting. Port Kent. And this is the picture that used to be on the halfway up the stairway when you come in Placid. Was that the one you had?
No. You're thinking of an enlargement that was made. But this is one of the bird's eye views of Plattsburgh, and these are very, very accurate. This one is 1899.
Great.
It shows all the buildings in their exactly in their correct positions, and it gives you a very good feeling for the extent of the village at that time. At the extreme western boundary, this is the Normal School,
mm-hmm.
which is where Hawkins Hall is today, Beekman Street. So actually, Beekman Street in Plattsburgh was the western boundary.
Right there, yes.
Mm-hmm. And it didn't extend much beyond Cumberland Avenue. This would be where
right.
the Georgia Pacific is located now. And then, although the military barracks, of course, was in place by 1899, here's the Saranac River making its bend around here.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the village was concerned, not very much beyond that to the
right.
south.
And as you look here, this was the fairgrounds at that time, and many of these buildings were there, I can remember, in the 30s, late 30s, and this is where the Clinton County Fair was. And then the big stadium was brought there, I think it was from Cleveland, and then, of course, it's now the athletic field, and the fairgrounds is out near Marsonville. Now, that'd be something great to have smaller pictures of those for sale.
Yes,
that
yes.
would be great. You could spend all kinds of time. You could pick out many of your own homes there.
Oh, a lot of visitors come.
I'm sure.
And they do.
I'm sure they do.
There's my
yes,
house.
Yes, absolutely.
Uh-huh.
Okay, as we move along, we're in the semi-permanent
yes.
gallery. Do you have names for each gallery by any chance? Not yet?
Not really.
Not yet.
Not at this
okay.
point, no. We're not tying ourselves into that just yet.
Okay.
A rocking chair from owned by a member of the Platt family at one time. But these are very interesting. These are the original brass and copper measures that were used at the farmer's market, which was in Trinity Park, Plattsburgh, where the modern farmer's market is. Farmers would bring their grain in, for example, and it would be measured in those official measures. You see it says Clinton County,
yes.
New York.
And they're very thick, right? Very,
very
thick. Now, so we don't miss that, because we were looking at the measures and we may have missed what you said. The farmer's market was at the Trinity
in
Park.
Trinity Park.
So that was the center
of the
village, and that's where a lot of business was transacted.
That's correct.
I didn't know that. All right, that's very important. I think that's very right in front of the city hall, and we're at
right,
the side of the city hall.
And the actual weighing probably, we believe, took place on what is now City Hall Place at the eastern side
mm-hmm.
end of the park.
So one person would sell to someone else, but using the official. Is that what's happening?
Well, the county was controlling.
The county
what was
going all right.
on there, but that's why they're inscribed
yes.
officially.
So there was only one set, you think? Would there be more
that
than one?
We don't,
don't know. Okay.
But I would guess that that was the official set, and
okay.
that's what it amounted
yep.
to.
And
you know, we have lost a light bulb up here. That's why it's rather
okay.
dark here. A piano called a square grand piano belonged to the Sachs family in Chazy. Matthew Sachs was one of the very early settlers in the Chazy area. And this was brought up the lake from, or I should say, well, let's see, when was it? 1840, brought by barge to Chazy, made in Boston.
He probably had a very good place to unload it, because I think that it was the Sachs family. I think it says Matthew Sachs on that stone building right at the end when there was a ferry went across over to...
And that was one of the early deep water ports on Lake Champlain. Behind us is a case which holds a lot of material having to do with hotels and hostelries in Clinton County. And... this rather strange-looking box that you see here with the cover on it is a bread dough box. The bread dough was put in that to raise, and it would be placed near the fire. And supposedly that one was used at the Robinson Tavern out on the ruin of the buildings is on the military turnpike on the way out to Ellenburg on the north side. And the story about this is that in 1817, President James Monroe visited the North Country, and the villagers of Plattsburgh decided to have a celebration, a picnic, a fete for him at the Robinson Tavern. And they used up all of the money that was supposed to build to buy a new fire engine, because they made it such a celebration. And that was all taking place in 1817.
Now, as I look in here, they've got a butter paddle. Mm-hmm. And there's a picture of a very, very unusual building in on that postcard, which I think was right across from the railroad station.
Yes, the 4K house.
That was the 4K house, mm-hmm. All right, where M.P. Myers is today, or was.
Was,
okay.
Yes.
And look at the some type of a pillars all around it. There's another picture of it right here.
That's correct.
Very, very prominent hotel, I guess. Right?
Yeah. It was.
Very. And I often wondered with these green bottles how they stood up, because they had a round bottom, and now I know there was a holder for them.
Torpedo bottles.
Torpedo.
Yes.
All right.
This silverware is all from Hotel Champlain,
which is now
one of the grand hotels in the area.
That burned about 1910.
Yes. Yes.
Originally. Okay. This is the type of things you can see here at the Clinton. There's something for everybody. And you can come down here, and I'll tell you, your 3 hours from 1 to 4, you'll spend it all here if you're interested at all. You will, and there's no reason why you wouldn't be interested. Here's another display completely filled with all types of things. Mostly wearing apparel, I guess. Or
ladies wearing apparel and accessories. Yes, it's a pretty display. It's fun.
Is this an autograph book?
Yes, it is.
I have an old one, nearly that old, on my desk the other day, and there were some relatives up from out of town, and they were looking at it, and they were looking at some dates in there, 1904, people had written in, and it was very great to write in. They don't do that anymore. Write them in yearbooks now for the school.
I remember that being done, and
you
were
30s,
supposed
40s.
To put in a verse.
Yeah, usually all little poems, you know. Roses are red, violets are blue, and et cetera, et cetera. All right.
The seed wreath is a real work of art. It was made in 1885, and it's a wreath which is constructed entirely of seeds, all collected, glued together in the shape of a wreath, and when you look at it, you see, really, it's a work of art. Isn't that amazing?
And you're talking many, maybe hundreds of hours, right?
Yes, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Any idea the age of something like
1885.
That? 1885. Oh, I'm sorry, 1885. 8 years old.
Made by Martha Larkin.
A great piece.
And
then the frame itself is a great piece.
The desk is from the Redford Glass Company. Bookkeeper's desk, it's been cut down. It would have been a high desk
they could write standing
at, yes. And the that's a certificate of election. Some of these objects since we were opening around the time of a forthcoming election, we included these. This flag is a really interesting one. It had been made for the 1884
Harrison
presidential election.
Mm-hmm.
And when it came time for the next election, the candidates for the previous election declined to stand. So this is a beautiful example of recycling. Instead of making a whole new flag banner,
yeah, see,
they
now
just
you're saying,
put new strips over the names.
Put strips over the names. I see that. They didn't bother getting the same size. Look, they're an extra inch wide. And is this an election box?
This is a ballot box.
Ballot box?
Used in Clinton County.
Election
yes.
return.
Mm-hmm. So instead of pulling a lever, you just dropped your ballot
uh-huh.
into the box.
And there's your finger mark so you can pull it and close it.
That's right. But don't let's forget the this object here.
Vote for women. Vote for women.
Yes. This was when suffrage was a very important political factor and women were doing their best to get the vote. The piece of calligraphy on the wall is interesting. It was it says, God bless our home, and it was made by one of the inmates at Clinton Prison. I'm not sure exactly what he meant by God bless our home.
some time ago, too.
Yes,
I mean, that's
very,
an old piece, right?
Very nice, yes.
And a map, of again, of Clinton County.
Yes, the map is... a very interesting 18. Early one by David Burr.
Huh.
And you might sometime want to compare that one with the 1856 map.
Yeah, we're going to do that as we leave the... here we're talking trunks.
Yes, this is all travel-related.
Yeah, so it's a big, I call it, I guess, a steamer trunk, the big one. Is that
That's
a steamer?
That's right. If you were quite wealthy and traveled by steamer or however by rail, you might have taken just about your entire wardrobe in that
mm-hmm.
one.
Is this more of a sewing basket type?
It's a little lady's reticule. It opens up at the sides
mm-hmm.
and made of, it's a basket, but mm-hmm. just for keeping little personal objects in. This one would have been for small clothing
mm-hmm.
and accessories. Mm-hmm. The little trunk over there was probably used for documents, keeping your papers in.
Mm-hmm. There's a little, like a little spool here, and it says number 4. And if you go over to this chart, it will say number 4 is a dainty 19th century lunch basket, all right? It'll give you a little information about these various ones. There's a number around each one if you're here and
she
you can...
Could, she might also have used it for just little objects
yeah.
that she was carrying around.
I could use it for a pocketbook in the summer.
Yes. This one is John Moffat's campaign trunk, Civil War.
Wow.
Period.
Wow.
Moffat was a name that... Mm-hmm.
That's a very unusual one right here.
Yes, medical bags.
Medical saddlebags when he made his rides on... horseback.
And the last piece just around the corner is what was known as a carpet bag, made of actual carpet. And
oh, yes, yes, yes.
That kind of, that purpose.
Yeah. And one other piece that we didn't look at, I guess, is a sewing machine. A real old sewing machine. The sign says, prior to the introduction of electricity, sewing machines were powered by a foot pedal. And you make your feet go on there. Patented in 1862, this graceful model was manufactured by Wilcox and Gibbs of New York City, which probably is a lot of information right there on it. I can see some printing. And it was a little belt that the big wheel would turn the little wheel and it could go faster. This could move at a less speed. This would go 5 or 6 or 7 times faster because of the mechanical advantage. Very unique. Very, very unique. A lot of these things I had not seen before.
Well, and now quite a number of these pieces have not been on view for some considerable time.
So if you've been to the museum before and you figure you don't have to come back, that's not true. There's a lot of things here you're going to enjoy and see, and I hope you'll, by watching us, we'll bring you here. We will now go over to one more map, and we'll take a short break and be right back.
That's a piece of furniture called an étagère.
Okay, we're looking at it for a piece of furniture, you were saying.
Yes, it's called an étagère or a whatnot, and as you can see, the shelves would have held ornaments.
Mm-hmm.
Lots of dusting in this.
Yes, I can
piece.
See that, yes. Yes.
but beautifully.
And moving,
made.
Yes, it is, certainly
very,
is.
Very
it's
nice.
Very intricate. And a very nice clock.
Well, this,
and it's working?
Yes, it is. And this wall clock was made at the end of the 19th century by clockmaker in Plattsburgh.
Yeah, by the way, yeah, make sure you get Plattsburgh, New York, the Baird Clock Company.
Right.
Someone told me about one of these. I think my uncle up in around the Katyville area told me about the clock mm-hmm. company from Plattsburgh, New York.
Wasn't here for very long, so it's all the more important that we still have
absolutely
an example.
Absolutely, and you notice that you usually have a glass here. In this case, you don't. It's solid wood.
Of
course, I'm interested in maps, and Calvin mentioned this map. There's a time right there, 1856, Plattsburgh, New York. And he was commenting to us that if you come over here, here is Champlain, New York, and this is the Ridge Road coming out here. And this is the road that goes to Rouse's Point and to Moore's. There was nothing. In 1856, from Ridge to Moore's, there was no road. The road went around through Angelville and then back to get to Moore's. And in 1869, I have maps that the
Beers.
And there is a road across mm-hmm. that. So in that 13-year period, a road appeared. Or else Mr. Legowski forgot to put it on, but there's no houses along there, none.
That's true.
And it's very interesting looking at maps for that reason. This is the La Bumbarb Road right here, for those of you in the area. And the where we now have our land, our convenience station would be right here, and there is nothing. Now known as the Cast Iron Road. It isn't there in this picture. Village of Champlain was. And you have to look at these things, not from a overall, but get to a certain point and kind of look mm-hmm. them over. And I'm
yes.
sorry, now you can tell me anything you want to tell me about the map.
Not at all. This is one of the largest maps we have in the museum, 1856, as you said. If we turn around, we'd be looking at one of the much smaller maps, but much, much earlier.
All right.
It's one of the earliest maps ever made of the Champlain Valley, Lake Champlain, and it's 1744.
And this is mostly because of the water and the little, of course, there wasn't too much going on in 1744.
No, we shouldn't forget that Native Americans inhabited this area for thousands of years before the white man came.
You know, we were at the Shazy School, and it's a big picture that was been in the school for years, and they got it in the new auditorium, and it says, Champlain discovers, Lake Champlain, and Calvin made the comment, there were some Indians there. He said, won't the Indians be glad they didn't know it was there? You know, for many years it was there, for many, many years. And you'd wonder how many Indians were in this area.
Well, native habitation has been traced back almost 10,000 years.
Mm-hmm. So, and they stay around the water, because that's
yes,
where...
Yes, and they went up and down the lake.
Mm-hmm.
So we're really Johnny-come-latelys.
Absolutely, and again, only a little over 200 years.
Right.
All right, is this the... Yeah, there's the railroad crossing... And the big hotel in
Station House Hotel
in Rouse's Point
mm-hmm.
that we talked about that burned. And we know the railroad went through there between 1850 and 1860. So that's it's showing in 1856, the Western Railroad came in from, I think, about 1850, as Peg told us. Peg Barcombe, if you're watching and listening, the lesson you gave me, I'm remembering it pretty well. Not exactly, but that shows your railroad and the buildings you showed us.
Sportsman's Pier.
That would be Sportsman's Pier. Yes, that's right. That's where that, I guess, burned, and there was a lot of movement of lumber up and down. And there's pictures. Those pictures you've added, or were that part of the map?
Oh, no,
that's part of the map. Here's Saranac Falls.
Well, as we were saying before, maps were frequently embellished with scenes of surrounding
mm-hmm.
places.
And this particular map shows the communities of Champlain Village and the rapids through here. This is the Champlain Village.
All
of them here, yeah. Keysville? Isn't that great? Well, I'll have to go back and look at that. Now, Centerville.
Morris Forks.
That was Morris Forks, all right. Ellenburg Corners. And here are the streets in Champlain. And there is a house where I own the house today, and it looks like it was one there then.
No.
Right here. No, right down here on the corner of Spruce.
Not where I live,
but the house I own. This house right here, Jay Churchill, was a doctor in town. Dr. Churchill, directly across the road from where I now live. And the one in the field here, I think, was a pigsty. It's very enjoyable when you see something you have a little bit of familiarity with, Helen.
Yes.
Again, it's been a pleasure being here with you. You're so courteous to show us all around. And anything else you want to tell us as we're closing off?
No, I think we've pretty much toured the museum. I hope everyone will want to come and visit it, and they'll be very welcome.
Any day except Wednesday or Thursday, it's open from 1 to 4, including Saturday and Sunday.
That's correct.
And come in, and there is a charge if you're not a member of $2.
$2 adults, $1.50 for seniors, and $1 for children.
Okay. And
don't forget that members of the Historical Association have free admission to the museum.
And they'll want to come back again and again and again.
Thank you very much.
And when you come in, talk to Helen. Tell her you saw her on television, and tell her how much she added to she made the show, and she'll show you things that she didn't take the time to show us today, I'm sure.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Helen Allen, the director of the Clinton County
Historical Museum
on the corner of Oak and Court Street, 48 Court Street. Bob Venn with What's Going On Here. Calvin Castine with the camera saying thanks very much for watching, and we hope you tune in every Sunday because we don't know where we're going next Sunday yet. Good afternoon, everybody, on a snowy winter day in Rouse's Point. We're in the Rouse's Point Library, and we're looking at the John Ross Room, his collection. And in here we see Dr. Alan Everest, and he is signing some of his books called Point of Fur. And there's been, I've seen at least 10 sold in and out so far, and he was starting about 2 o'clock. It's 2:20. I'm Bob Venn. The program's called What's Going On Here? Calvin Castine on the camera. And we're going to be talking to Dr. Everest a little bit later, and maybe some other people here, and just see what this is all about and find out more about the book and how the Zerlos were involved. We'll be right back. This semi-smiling gentleman next to me is Dr. Alan Everest. And if you haven't met him, that's why we're here, because we're at the Ross Library, and he's been signing, autographing books called The Point of Fur on Lake Champlain by Alan S. Everett, but it is Dr. Everett, Plattsburgh State University. For how many years, Doc?
36.
But had to be something with
now.
History. You're out now.
Yeah.
Well, no, don't say you're out. It sounds like you've been released or something.
Well,
like
I
a prisoner.
They didn't mind seeing me walk away.
They didn't? All right. Well, we'll talk a little bit about Point of Fur. That's what he's up here for, to sign these books on this snowy day at the Ross Library, John Putnam Ross Room in the Dodge Library on Lake Street in Rouse's Point.
There.
Dr. Everest, or Everest. I want to say Everest, so much as I say. Where are you from? Where were you born? Are you native up in this area?
Just across the lake in Vermont.
Where?
Addison.
Addison.
Well, my hometown is New Haven, but the Everest came to Addison before the Revolution. And I had two ancestors that were in the Green Mountain Boys, famous in the Revolution.
Absolutely.
But I've never applied for the DAR.
You never applied for the DAR?
No.
Tell me, were they also historians like yourself? Were they interested in history? They weren't.
Not particularly, no.
Okay, so you were raised in Vermont?
I went to college in Burlington.
UVM?
Yeah. And then 2 degrees from Columbia. But World War II came between the degrees. I got drafted before Pearl Harbor.
Drafted before? I didn't know they were drafting before the war, yes?
1 year, and supposed to be a turnover, but they'd get people trained just in case.
Uh-huh.
But I'd been in 4 months, and the bombs dropped on Pearl Harbor.
Were you Navy or Army?
Army, Air Force.
Air Force, all right, yes.
Before there was an independent Air Force.
And then you came back afterward, and you got your other degrees afterward? You got your your doctorate afterward?
Yeah.
And then when did you come to Plattsburgh? Was that your first school that you taught at?
Well, I taught at junior college in Vermont before the war. But this was what I came to right out of out of the Army, almost, or Air Force. in 1947.
About the same time the Champlain College came to Plattsburgh. The same time, yes.
Mm-hmm. But I came to the what was then Teachers College.
Mm-hmm.
It's changed names several times since then.
You must have liked it. You stayed there to the bitter end. 36 years, you said?
Huh? 36 years. Whose end are you talking about?
Tell me, if you're going to be more wise than I am here, it's going to make it tough on me. You come up back more remarks than I've got.
Well, you ask questions. They call it a snappy.
How many students would you teach in a given year, approximately, would you say?
Well, my last few years, I was teaching each semester about 150. Classes had gotten pretty large.
In each semester? So that'd be 300 a year.
Yeah.
And you're talking 36 years, so like you're talking maybe...
Well, those were the later years.
Yes, but you could be 5,000 students different.
Oh, I think so.
All of that have either learned or come under your tutelage, what should I say? Well, one or the other?
Some of them even admit it.
You know, we were... we've seen you down at the auction or the flea markets they have there for the Clinton County Historical Society in Trinity Park in front of City Hall for the last 10 or more years, I guess. And everyone knows you, I'm sure, in the area. Your picture's been in the paper. You've written many, many books. And you've made a lot of impact on a lot of lives that people have enjoyed history. Were you a friend of our benefactor here, John Ross?
I certainly was. He was Jack to me. I think he was to everybody, for that matter.
You know, I've known him many times. Mm-hmm. I worked with him. I've never called him Jack. I always called him John. I don't know why. I know a lot of people called him Jack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I know him well. He was on the board of the historical for quite a long time, and overlapping some of the years I was. And he was on the Crown Point Foundation for years, and so was I.
Uh-huh. All right. Now, we don't know much about books, but let's say this point of fare, which you're here to sign, and they're selling them today for $8.95, and if you don't have one of these, they can be picked up at the Historical Society's office at 48 Court Street in Plattsburgh, the corner of Brinkerhoff, Oak, I should say. I keep wanting to say Brinkerhoff.
Oak and Court.
And it's the story of Point of Fair, just out here at Kings Bay. And we know that this was underwritten, the finances came from Eugene and John Zerlo, who asked you to write this book. Is that where it came about?
A little more indirectly. They appealed to... John Zerlo is on the county board and legislature.
Right.
And he asked Bingle for ideas.